morning all, and welcome to the online classroom hosting by SAP. We are having a 1 hour session now for the sixth semester polytechnic students of mechanical engineering stream. Topic for the session is centrifugal pumps from the fourth module of the subject hydraulic machines. Faculty taking the session is Mr. Ranjit VP, head of department of mechanical engineering, Government Polytechnic College, Chelakara. He did both his BTech and MTech from College of Engineering, Trivandrum. Now he had submitted PhD thesis under Kerala University and waiting for open defense. Also, he has got more than 24 years of teaching experience in College of Engineering and different polytechnic colleges. Welcome, Ranjit sir.
Thank you.
Sir, one more thing for the students. Students can ask your doubts using the QA facility. Your doubts will be clarified by Ranjit sir in the QA session. Sir, now you can start your session.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jason. Good morning, all. Today, we are starting the remaining portion of the fourth module on 24th April. Studying that is we mentioned and it's working and everything. Today we are taking that centrifugal pump and then different types of pump. Okay. This portion that is mainly concentrating the theory, but in the reciprocating pump, some problem part also. In centrifugal pump, most of the portion that is theory. Okay, now I'm starting the centrifugal pump. That is centrifugal pump. Centrifugal pump is a rotodynamic pump. Rotodynamic pump means there is a rotating member. That rotating member is called impeller. This impeller is rotating inside the casing. Then when it is rotating inside the casing, that is an area increasing casing. Then a head developing. That head is called a rotodynamic head. So that this centrifugal pump is called a rotodynamic pump. Clear? So centrifugal pump is an example of the rotodynamic pump. Rotodynamic pump means in which there is a rotating member. That rotating member is called impeller. This impeller is rotating inside an area increasing casing, a head developing. That head is called a rotodynamic head. This rotodynamic head developing is directly proportional to the density of the fluid to be pumped. Here, before that, what is the basic principle of centrifugal pump? That is, centrifugal pump, the principle is certain mass of fluid is made to rotate along a circular path with an external force. It is thrown away from the axis of rotation. That force, that is the centrifugal force. In order to keep that in the circular path, a radially inward force is acting. That radially inward force is called the centripetal force. This centripetal force is equal and opposite of the centrifugal force. This centrifugal force is equal to m omega square r or mv square by r. M is the mass of fluid and omega is the angular velocity and r is the radius and or v is the linear velocity. That is the basic principle of centrifugal pump. And then next, that is a centrifugal pump. It's a figure. That is the fourth one. Then please, that fourth slide, Jishan. Fourth one. Here, the pump is this one, in which in the middle, there is a blue color that is called the eye of the impeller. And there is one yellow portion that is the impeller. And then there is an area increasing casing, different types of casing. I'll explain it later. And there is one pipe that take water from sump to inlet of the pump. It is connecting sump to eye of the impeller or center of the pump. That pipe is called a suction pipe. At the lower end of the pipe, there is a strainer and a foot valve. This strainer prevents the entry of the debris or leaves or other foreign particles into the pipeline. It prevents. And then there is a foot valve. That foot valve, that is a one-way valve, that permits fluid only to flow in the upward direction. It does not allow the fluid to flow back. When this impeller is rotating, a head developing, that is called a rotodynamic head. This rotodynamic head developing is directly proportional to density of the fluid to be pumped. So when the fluid, when the head is sufficient to lift the fluid, we can open the delivery valve and then fluid is flowing out through the delivery pipe. So here, water is sucking from the sump and discharges to the delivery tank through delivery pipe. So there is a head, suction head and delivery head. That the suction head is the level from the sump level to level of the water to center of the pump. That is the suction head. And from center of the pump to delivery portion, that is the delivery head. So this is the total head, that is called a static head. This suction head plus delivery head. You already did, all the third year student did the experiment in centrifugal pump in our hydraulics lab. Okay. Then, next one, that is before starting, please, next slide. That is priming. What is priming? That is before starting a centrifugal pump, first procedure is priming. That means, that is, I already mentioned the when the fluid is rotating inside the casing, a head developing, that head is called a rotodynamic head. This rotodynamic head developing is directly proportional to density of the fluid to be pumped. Okay, we know that density of, suppose if the fluid is water, if water is pumping, then the density of water is 1000 kg per meter cube, but that we know. But at the same time, some air is entrapped inside the suction pipe, casing, or a portion of the delivery. The head developing is not sufficient to lift the fluid. If any air, suppose some fraction of air is entrapping inside the casing, that is the impeller is rotating idly without sucking any fluid. So we have to remove that much air, that entrapped air. In order to remove that entrapped air, open the delivery valve, and also there is a vent, the air vent portion. Open the air vent to release the air entrapped inside it. And through delivery, we can pour the fluid to be pumped. If water is pumping, we have to pour water. If oil is pumping, we have to pour oil. And when the suction pipe, casing, and a portion of the delivery is filled with the fluid to be pumped, then the entrapped air will come out through that air vent. And after releasing all the air, after removing all the air, then we can close the air vent and close the delivery valve. This process is called the priming. So this is an important question. What is priming? Priming is the process in which to remove the entrapped air inside the casing, suction pipe or portion of delivery with the fluid to be pumped. The need of priming is the head developing is directly proportional to the density of the fluid to be pumped. Comparing with the density of water, the density of air may be very small. That is, we can find out the density, that is PV equal to MRT, from the characteristic equation. That is, we can find that density. That is, while calculating that density, that is the PV by RT, that is P, that is the here the atmospheric pressure, 1.01325 into 10 raised to 5 Newton per meter square. And then, while substituting that values, then we will get a density of air that is based on the temperature. That is, T is the temperature. Suppose the temperature 30 degree, then we will get 1.167 kilogram per meter cube. That is, when the density of the liquid is 1000, but the air entrapped is 1.167. So it will not develop the required head. The head developing directly proportional to density. So that much of air we have to remove. That process is called the priming. Okay. Then, next one. Then in the centrifugal pump, there are a lot of casing. The main part of the centrifugal pump, one rotative member, that is the impeller. This impeller is covered with a casing. That casing, different types of casing. There are three main type of three. That is, one is the volute casing, and the second one is the vortex casing, and then casing with the gate veins or gate blades. First one is, that is also an important question at 6 mark question, which are the different types of casing. First one is the volute casing. In the volute casing, you can see the impeller with the backward curved blade in the impeller. First, middle, that is the eye of the impeller, and then the impeller in which backward curved blade. And then a casing, that is the volute casing, that is an area increasing casing. Here, that area is gradually increased. When the fluid is made to thrown away from the axis of rotation, a head developing, and then the pressure developing there is equivalent to mv square by r, or mv square mv m omega square r. Here the area is gradually increasing. At that time, the velocity, that is playing the continuity equation, the area increasing, velocity decreasing. So that velocity energy is converting into pressure energy. But here, the casing is designed to maintain the velocity constant. That is, here, when the fluid is made to rotate along the impeller, in addition to rotodynamic head, its angular momentum is also changing. That also develops a pressure due to this. This also increases the pressure that delivers the fluid to upward. That is, when the while after priming, then while we closed the center, that is, delivery valve is closing before starting. Delivery valve is closing before starting to develop the, that is, to reduce the starting torque. After that, when the head developing is sufficient, then a sound change will come. At that time, we can open the delivery valve. Fluid is coming out. When the fluid is made to flow outward, that is, a partial vacuum is creating at the eye of the impeller. That helps to suck the fluid. In the casing, that is, in the volute casing, when the fluid is flowing through this area increasing casing, fluid is, that is, rotating along that way. So there is a tendency of eddy formation. Next slide. this eddy formation, that is the, this eddy formation loses the energy, so that the efficiency of this volute casing is slightly less. Okay, that is the drawback of the volute casing, that is volute casing due to the eddy formation, a loss of energy occurs that reduces the efficiency. Then the second one is the vortex casing. This vortex casing, in which in addition to, that is in order to remove that eddy formation, or in order to limit the eddy formation, a circular disc is providing in between the impeller and the casing. So please show the next slide, in which that figure you can see, that is this this one, that is in which that is middle portion, first one is the volute casing, second one in the middle portion, that is the impeller, and then the casing, in between that a circular disc is provided. While providing that circular chamber, that prevent the eddy formation, so that energy losses minimizing and efficiency of the pump, that is increasing. Okay, and then the third one is the diffuser type casing, in which that is there is an impeller and then a guide vane that is outer of the impeller, that is in between the casing and the impeller, there is a guide vane, a blades, a lot of blades are there, that acts as a diffuser. Okay, there is a disc that is in between that, there is a gateway, that is the diffuse, that convert velocity energy to pressure energy, so that that is the main aim of the pump, is to increase pressure energy of the fluid, so that this diffuser converting velocity energy to pressure energy, so that pressure developing, head developing is more. So these are the three different types of casings. Okay, that is an important question, three, which are the different types of casing, that is in the sitter site there is a model question paper in which also this question is 6 mark 1, so everyone must study it properly with the figure and explain that. Okay, and then main part of the centrifugal pump. Next slide. Kishan, please show. Okay, main part of the centrifugal pump. I already explained the centrifugal pump consists of an impeller, that is the rotating member, and a casing, and the suction pipe with the foot valve and the strainer, and the delivery pipe. That also an important question. Draw the block diagram of the centrifugal pump and explain its function, explain its working. That is an also a 6, 7 mark or 8 mark question. That is also an important one. Impeller, that is the rotating part of the centrifugal pump. It is a wheel provided with a series of backward curved blade. It is mounted on the shaft coupled with the electric motor. That is this pump, that is a power consuming device. So in order to rotate that impeller, a prime mover is required, that is the electric motor. Electric motor coupling with the pump shaft. And then next one is the casing. Casing, that is an airtight chamber, that is mentioned data. If there is any air entrapping, it will not produce the required head. So the casing must be airtight, and that surround the impeller. That is, kinetic energy of water discharged at the outlet of the impeller is converting into pressure energy. That is the function of casing. That is, and then different types of casings. Okay. And then the suction pipe. Suction pipe means a pipe that is used to lift water from sump to center of the pump. Here, center of the pump, there is a height difference from sump level to center of the pump. That is the suction head. In the suction pipe, lower end that is dipped into the sump. And that is in the next figure, you can see working of a centrifugal pump. Okay, please show that next figure. Okay, this one. Here, this sump, water from the sump is taking to the center of the pump. This pipe is the suction pipe. That is there at the end, at the bottom end, there is a strainer and a foot valve. And then water first end is the eye of the impeller. And then this water is rotating along the circular path, head developing, that is the centrifugal head. When that head is sufficient to lift the fluid, this delivery valve is open. That delivery valve is in the delivery pipe, but it should be nearer to the pump. Then water that is lifting through the delivery tank through this delivery pipe. So second one is the delivery, last one is the delivery pipe. That is delivery pipe which connects the outlet of the pump to delivery head. That is the head required to lift the fluid. Delivery valve should be nearer to the pump, that is for easy controlling. That is for during the time of starting, we must close the delivery valve. That is only in the experimental side that we need. But in our home, that is, it is connected with the motor. So when you switch on it, the water that is enters to the tank. Okay. Then this is the working. After priming, delivery valve is kept closed. And what is the need of closing the delivery valve? That is to reduce the starting torque. And the electric motor is started to rotate the impeller. The rotation of the impeller in the casing full of liquid produced the forced vertex that imparts a centrifugal head. And when the liquid is passing through or revolving, passing through the revolving wheel, that is the impeller, angular momentum changes. That results the increase in pressure. That is, pressure at any point in the pump, that is proportional to square of the angular velocity. That is m omega square r. That is the centrifugal force. So this pressure developing is proportional to square of the angular velocity. After developing required head, delivery valve opens and then the fluid is flowing outward through the radial direction to the outer circumference with the high velocity and pressure. That is when due to this action, at the eye of the impeller, a partial vacuum is created. Due to this partial vacuum, it helps to lift the fluid from sump to center of the pump, so that the fluid is coming into the suction pipe. The high pressure of the liquid leaving the impeller is utilized for lifting the liquid in the required height. Okay. Then the burden and the discharge of a centrifugal pump. This centrifugal pump is a reversed reaction turbine. That is called the centrifugal pump is the reversed reaction turbine. Because in the reaction turbine, fluid enters the, that is an inward flow turbine. Inward flow means water enter from outside and then it leaves through inside. But here it is an outward flow turbine, that is reversed inward flow reaction. That means here it is outward. That is because here first water enters the eye of the impeller, that is at the inside of the pump, and then fluid is flowing out, so that it is called outward flow. Okay, here two arc you can see there, R1 and R2. That is the impeller. Inside the impeller is the backward curved blade. And from the center, eye, that portion you can see at the center. From there, R1, R2 is marked. That is the eye of the impeller. From there, water striking on the tip of the backward curved blade with a velocity that is V1, that is the absolute velocity of the jet. And then when the water is striking, when the water is coming with the velocity V1, but at the same time the bucket is moving, bucket velocity is the, or blade velocity is U1. There is, the fluid is entering radially, that is alpha is the angle, that alpha angle is 90 there. This alpha, that is the velocity that makes with the velocity of jet, that is the gate blade angle at inlet. Alpha is the gate blade angle at inlet. And then bucket is moving, that is perpendicular U1. So both are moving, jet is moving, bucket is moving. So the velocity with which water strikes on the backward curved blade is relative velocity, that is VR1. And the blades are so smooth, so that without any loss, fluid that is passing through that impeller or curved blades, and then it leaves outward with the velocity, relative velocity, what are leaving out with the velocity, relative velocity. So there an angle phi is there, that is the main angle at outlet is phi, and theta is the main angle at inlet. And then beta is the gate blade angle at outlet. So you have to draw, you can draw this velocity diagram, velocity triangle with that impeller. You already studied that in our reaction turbine. It is the continuation of that, because it is the reversed reaction turbine. Okay. And then the work done. How much is the work done? Work done by the impeller on the water, by drawing the inlet and outlet velocity triangle, what then we can find out. Here, alpha angle is 90, that is the radial inlet, so that world velocity at inlet is 0, because alpha angle is 90. Then, here, N is the speed of the impeller in RPM, and D1 is the diameter of the impeller at inlet. That is 2 into R1, that is the D1. U1 is the tangential velocity of the impeller at inlet. Here, this centrifugal pump is the reverse of radially inward reaction turbine, that is called the centrifugal pump is an outward flow pump. Water that is flowing outward enters at the inlet and leaves out. Then the burden by the water on the runner per second, per unit weight of water. That is from the basic equation. That is, here we are considering the unit weight. So that 1 by g. If we are considering total, then w by g. But here it is 1 by g into vw1 u1 minus vw2 u2. That is the basic equation. From that basic equation, we know the velocity of whirl at the inlet is zero. Therefore, the burden by the impeller on the water per second, per unit weight of water is equal to minus 1 by g into vw1 u1 minus vw2 u2, so that it become vw2 u2, 1 by g into vw2 u2. Burden by the impeller on the water per second is w by g into vw2 u2. Vw2 is the whirl velocity at outlet, u2 is the bucket velocity or blade wheel velocity at the outlet, blade velocity, and w is the weight of water. Here it is, there is a minus sign because it is a power consuming device. Electrical power is utilizing for the running of the pump, so it is a power consuming device. And then W is the weight of the water. That weight of the water is equal to rho g q, where q is the volume of water. That is equal to area into velocity of flow. That area is calculating pi into d into b. D is the miller dia and b is the width of the blade. And Vf1 is the velocity of flow. In reaction turbine, velocity of flow at inlet and outlet that are equal. Here Vw1 pi into D1 B1 into Vf1. That is the discharge. That discharge at inlet is equal to discharge at outlet pi D2 B2 into Vf2. You did a lot of problems in reaction turbine using this formula, where B1, B2 is the width of the blades or width of the impeller at inlet and outlet, velocity of flow, Vf1, Vf2, that is at inlet and outlet. Okay. And then efficiency of a centrifugal pump. Efficiency, there are mainly three different efficiencies in centrifugal pump. Manometric efficiency, mechanical efficiency, and overall efficiency. This is also an important question, sometimes a 2-mark question or 6-mark question, which are the different efficiencies involved in the centrifugal pump. In centrifugal pump, power transmitted from the shaft of the electric motor to pump shaft. That is, electrical power is supplying to run the pump. So, electrical motor shaft coupled with the pump shaft. And from the pump, from the shaft shaft of the pump, shaft impeller is connecting with the, connected in this shaft. So, power from pump to impeller. So power is decreasing from shaft of the pump to impeller and then to water. So losses from first pump and then impeller and then outlet. Then the main efficiencies are manometric efficiency, mechanical efficiency, overall efficiency. Suppose if it is a 2-mark question, you have to write only that names, which are the efficiencies, important efficiencies involved in the centrifugal pump. And then what is that manometric efficiency? Manometric efficiency is the ratio of manometric head to head imparted by the impeller. Okay, manometry head to head imparted by the impeller. That is an important question. Manometry head. I'll say it. That is, manometry head is the head against which a centrifugal pump has to work. Everyone must by heart that or understand that properly. The head against which a centrifugal pump has to work. That is the manometry head. So manometric efficiency is manometry head divided by head imparted by the impeller to water. That is, manometry head is HM, manometry head. And the head imparted is head imparted by the impeller, that we know, 1 by G into Pw to U. Okay. So manometry efficiency is the first one. And then mechanical efficiency. It is the ratio of power available at the impeller to power available at the shaft of the centrifugal pump. Pardon? That is W by G into Vw to U2 by shaft power. That is the mechanical efficiency. Efficiency, output by input. Here the input is the shaft power. Output is the power available at the input.
Excuse me. Namada first 35 minutes kainittund ṭa.
Then one more that
over. Seri sir, okay.
Overall efficiency is the last one. That is the power output of the pump to power input of the pump. That is W into HM, that is in kilowatt, divided by shaft power. Shaft power also in kilowatt. Okay. And then comparison. Is there any question section in between that?
Please. Sir, namku oru question vannittundu. Sir, one question. What is manometric head of a centrifugal pump?
That is what I already mentioned. The manometric head against which centrifugal pump has to work. Oru centrifugal pump work cheyyunnathu ede head il aayirikkanam. Aa head aanu manometric head. Head against which a centrifugal pump has to work. That is the manometric head. That is an important question. Okay. Head against which a centrifugal pump has to work. Okay.
Sir, no more questions so far. Sir, continue with all. Class continue with all.
That is, this is one also an important question. Comparison. That is, or differentiate centrifugal pump and the reciprocating pump. Reciprocating pump we already studied, and then centrifugal pump, that is today we covered. What is the comparison? Then the first one, centrifugal pump is a rotodynamic pump. In reciprocating pump is a positive displacement pump. Everyone know that. And then discharge capacity of the centrifugal pump is much more than reciprocating pump. That is, reciprocating pump is used to lift low quantity of water to greater head. But centrifugal pump, that is used to take a large quantity of water to relatively lower head. Okay, that is, the discharge capacity of the centrifugal pump is much larger than reciprocating pump. And the centrifugal pump used for lifting high viscous fluid like oil, muddy and sewage water, paper pulp, sugar molasses, chemicals, etc. But reciprocating pump can handle pure water or less viscous liquid that should be free from the impurities. Otherwise, that is, in reciprocating pump, there is a lot of moving part and the piston and then valves, everything. So if there is impurities, that may make a frequent trouble to reciprocating pump. So reciprocating pump, that is used to lift less viscous fluid. and then centrifugal pump can be operated at a very high speed so that it can be directly coupled with the electric motor, so that there is no problems of cavitation or flow suppression, etc. But in reciprocating pump, it can run at a slow speed to avoid the cavitation and the flow suppression. Hence, the speed is reduced. So, speed reduction devices are using in reciprocating pump. So, sometimes a belt drive, that is, belt is used to reduce the speed of the motor, and then it is connecting with the pump. And then maintenance cost of the centrifugal pump is low because there is no moving part. Then periodically its checkup is sufficient. Then the reciprocating pump maintenance cost is high because a lot of moving part, so that it need a frequent replacement. And reciprocating pump can build up very high pressure, hence it is used for lifting oil from very high deep wells. Okay, and then static head and dynamic, static head and manometric head. That also I already explained. Static head is the vertical distance between sump level to center of the delivery. Okay, HS plus HD. HS is the suction head. HD is the delivery head. From the sender to the level of the water in the delivery tank is the delivery head. From the sump to center of the pump is the suction head. Sum of these two is the static head. Okay. Static head is the vertical height. Okay. And then manometric head is the head against which a centrifugal pump has to work. It is the total head that must be produced by a pump to satisfy the external requirement. Okay, then manometric head, that is VW to U2 by G if there is no losses, and if there is some losses, total head difference between the inlet and outlet. Or otherwise we can say this manometric head is suction head plus delivery head plus head loss due to friction in the suction pipe HFS plus head loss due to friction in the delivery pipe plus V square by 2G, that VD square by 2G is the velocity head at the delivery pipe. That in these three way you can explain the manometric head. So that is, if it is a 6-mark question, you have to write all these things. Manometric head is the head against which a centrifugal pump has to work. It is the total head produced in the pump to satisfy the external requirement. And that three equations and it's what is X stands for, that also you have to specify. VW2 world velocity at outlet, U2 bucket velocity at outlet, etc. Okay, that is the manometric head. And then this is also an important 2-mark question. Net positive suction head. This net positive suction head is, it is denoting NPSH. Sometimes the question is, what is NPSH? Net positive suction head. It is the head required to make the liquid flow through the suction pipe. That is, in the suction pipe, in order to lift the fluid, always passes from high pressure to low pressure. At the eye of the impeller, there is a partial vacuum. At the sump level, there is the atmospheric pressure. So, in order to suck the fluid, what must be the pressure required in the suction pipe? That is the net positive suction head. It is called positive because that the pressure is greater than that of, more than that of the vacuum pressure. Partial vacuum is creating inside the impeller or eye of the impeller. Due to that pressure difference, water is sucking through the suction pipe. So this net positive suction head is at the inlet of the pump, that is equal to absolute pressure at the inlet of the pump minus vapor pressure head plus velocity head. It is the total suction head. That is equal to absolute pressure head at the inlet of the pump minus vapor pressure head plus velocity head, that is P1 by rho g minus PV by rho g, that is the vapor pressure head plus velocity head, that is the net positive suction head. And then a 6 mark, important 6 mark or sometimes 7 mark question, specific speed of a centrifugal pump. Specific speed means it is the speed of a geometrically similar pump, that is the shape of the pump is identical with the actual one. And if it delivers 1 meter cube of water, 1 meter cube of water while working under a head of 1 meter, that is pump working at a head of 1 meter, and during that time it discharging 1 meter cube of water per second. At that time, at which speed that pump is working, that speed is the specific speed. Clear? Specific speed is the speed of a geometrically similar pump that should deliver 1 meter cube of liquid per second while working under a head of 1 meter. This specific speed is used to compare the performance of different pump. That is, its derivation is not included in our syllabus, but you must study that formula. It is used to predict the behavior of the pump, and it is used to compare the performance of different pump. But that may be similar size, but the that is size may be different. Then that specific speed is equal to n into root q divided by hm raised to 3/4. N is the speed of the impeller or speed of the pump. Q is the discharge in meter cube per second. Hm is the manometry head, that is hm raised to 3/4. Okay, this n is speed in rpm, q discharge, and hm manometry head in meter. That also an important one. And then how we can select a pump based on specific speed, that is, it is type of pump. In that tabular column you can see that centrifugal pump, it is slow speed radial flow pump. Then if it is a slow speed radial flow pump, specific speed is in between 300 to 900. If it is a medium speed radial flow turbine, it is 900 to 1500. If it is a high speed radial flow, 1500 to 2400. Mixed flow pump or screw pump, there the specific speed 2400 to 5000. If it is axle flow or propeller pump, just like a Kaplan turbine, that is the reverse the axial flow turbine. Kaplan turbine is an axial flow turbine. This axial flow pump means it is the reverse of axial flow turbine. There the specific speed 3400 to 15,000. Okay, and just like that, based on the head, this centrifugal pump is maybe low head, high head, and medium head. The head is less than 10 meter, up to 10 meter it is low head, and in between 10 and 40 it is called the medium head. And if it is more than 40 meter, it is called the high head. Okay. And then next is the cavitation. Cavitation, that is also an important question. Cavitation. Cavitation is the phenomenon of formation of vapor bubbles after flowing liquid in a region. And this pressure, if the pressure is falling below the vapor pressure, the gases dissolved in the water will come out and it moves along with the fluid. And whenever it reaches a high pressure region, this bubbles collapse and a high pressure is developing. That is, the bubbles are collapsing, not one or two bubbles, it is thousands of bubbles. So when this bubbles is collapsing, a lot of free space occurs, so water rush into that region, so that a sound that will occur, okay, due to that pressure difference. This process, that is due to that high pressure, that is, it may hit on the pipe surface and the cavities may produce there. That process is called the cavitation. Okay, that is an important question. That is, whenever the fluid is flowing through a pipe, when the pressure become less than or equal to vapor pressure, the gases dissolved in the liquid will come out and it moves along with the fluid, and whenever it reaches a high pressure region, this bubbles collapse and a fluid from the surrounding region rushes into that space, so a high pressure developing, and that due to that high pressure, a knocking sound, a hammering action that will occur, and it may erode the surface of the pipe, so cavities will form there. That in order to avoid that cavitation, there is a relation, Thomas cavitation factor, that is used to indicate when that cavitation occurs. So how we can limit that cavitation? That is equal to, cavitation factor is equal to net positive suction head divided by manometric head. Okay, net positive suction head by manometric head. Next one is the multi-stage pump. So please, next, multi-stage pump. That is, if one is...
Excuse me, sir. Sir.
Yes.
Sir, last 10 minutes.
Okay. So a lot of portion has to cover.
Sir, continue with it, sir.
Okay, a multi-stage pump, that is, in a single centrifugal pump, the fluid can be lifted to one particular height and also discharge will be a moderate amount from the lower head to the large quantity of water discharge from lower head. But if the impellers are connected, if the impellers of the centrifugal pump are connected in series and parallel, we can increase the head and discharge. Such pumps are called a multi-stage pump. That is also an important one, multi-stage. In multi-stage pump, first one, that is, next slide, multi-stage pump. Next figure, with a figure. Next one, okay. Multi-stage pump for high speed. That is here, the impellers are connected in series in the same shaft. A number of impellers are connected in series. Water enters from the sump and then it pressurizes in the first impeller. After that, that pressurized fluid is enters to the second impeller. So while reaching the second impeller, the head of the liquid, that is pressure of the liquid, that is increased. So the head pressure, head can increase by connecting the impellers in series. So that is the first one, water from the suction pipe enters to the first impeller of the first impeller at the inlet and then discharged it to the outlet, and then it is reaching to the second one, second impeller. There the pressure is again increasing so that the head of the impeller can be increased. Okay, that is the first one. And then second, a multi-stage pump for higher discharge. Position, please, the next slide. Okay, this one. Here, the impellers are connected in parallel. The was that is fluid is sucking from the same sump. The first pump suck the fluid and that its discharge is connecting in a common pipe. Again, the second pump take water from the same pump through that suction pipe of water is sucking and then it discharges in the second pipe, that is in the common pipe. So there in the common pipe, here the discharge is Q1 plus Q2. So here the pumps are connected in parallel. That is not pump, impellers are connected in parallel so that the discharge can be increased. These are the two different, two types of pump. That is, it is suction, that is the impeller connected in series and impeller connected in parallel. Here, impeller connected in series, the total head become number of impellers are connecting seriously, N. Suppose N is the impellers, number of impellers connected in series, and head imparted from one pump is H. So, total head developed is equal to N into HM, N into manometry head. But in when the pump impellers are connected in parallel, the discharge is increasing. There the total discharge is equal to number of impellers are connected in parallel N and discharge from one pump, that is Q. So N into Q. Or suppose if it is Q1, Q2, Q3 are the discharges from each pump, then if the impellers are connected in parallel, total discharge Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3. Okay. So these things are in the centrifugal pump. And then we have to move to different types of pump. And before that, in the last portion, in the last day, that is on 24th, I missed one portion from the reciprocating pump and air vessel. That is air vessel. Okay. Air vessel, that is in centrifugal pump, in single acting reciprocating pump, discharge is intermittent, and if it is double acting, discharge is continuous, but this discharge is pulsating just like AC, alternating current. DC, that is straight up, but AC pulsating. So here in the reciprocating pump, discharge is pulsating. In order to get a continuous and smooth discharge, a device that is connecting in the delivery pipe, that is the air vessel. In most of the positive displacement pump, air vessels are connecting in the suction side and the delivery side. That is, when the crank is rotating initially from 0 to 180, there is more acceleration. So more quantity of fluid is sucking through the suction pipe. A portion of fluid that is enters to the air vessel. This air vessel is a closed cylindrical vessel. Its top portion contains compressed air and the bottom portion contains liquid. These two are separated by a membrane that is called the diaphragm. When the fluid is rushes into the air vessel through the bottom opening, it pushes the compressed air above. And when there is a deceleration, that is crank is rotating. So 0 to 90, there is an acceleration, and 90 to 180, there is a deceleration. During that time, this compressed air pushing that fluid to the fluid downward so that more or less same quantity of water that is enters into the cylinder. And also after compressing the discharge, initially it is more that a part of the discharge enters into the air vessel in the delivery side and it pushes the compressed air above. This liquid pushes the compressed air above during the deceleration time. This compressed air pushing that fluid downward so that a more or less is more or less same discharge that is always in the obtained in the reciprocating pump. For that there is a device called air vessel. Okay, then next one is the hydraulic ram. That is an important question. There are different types of pump. In addition to centrifugal pump, a lot of other pumps are included in our syllabus. First one is the hydraulic ram. A hydraulic ram in which there is a supply tank. You can see a supply tank. That is normally what is hydraulic ram means. If large quantity of water is available at a lower head, then without any energy source, we can lift less quantity of water to a greater height. That device is the hydraulic ram. So hydraulic ram is a pump which is used to lift less quantity of water to a greater height if large quantity of water available at a relatively lower head